nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 2.2. So this will actually go into more details about how ray optical matrices work. So the challenge with ray optical matrices is that we know the elementary forms, but what if we actually had more than one optical element at a time? And so of course, most optical systems will have many elements together. So how can we actually understand the interaction between all those elements? Of course, it could potentially be very difficult, but because everything is essentially linear, we actually have a fairly easy approach to combining different elements, which is based on linear algebra. And so you can see here basically the concept, which is that you have some sort of input system, which is represented by a height, y in, and an angle, theta in. Okay, so this is basically the ray that's coming into the system. And then it goes through different ray matrices. And so these ray matrices are an abstract representation of the actual elements, like propagating through free space or high index medium, or like a curved surface or thin lens and so on. And so then you actually get to multiply all these together until you get to the output. And so then mathematically, you actually put everything in the reverse order in which it occurs, starting from the input. So you go from the element that's closest to the output, so O3 in this case, times O2 times O1. So those are the three optical elements, times the input, y in, theta in. And so this is all like using typical like linear algebra matrix multiplication. And it looks like it might be opposite of what you expect, but this is not a typo. It's actually supposed to be that. And it makes sense if you think about it, because as you may know from linear algebra, when you multiply O1 times yn theta in, that gives you kind of the first step in the chain and so on. So you could actually use it for a fairly complex system. This is just one example where maybe we have input here of array pass through high index medium, and then we pass through thin lens, and then we pass through kind of a half thick lens, and then a mirror, and then output. And so we can basically extract all the elementary optical matrices that we discussed in lecture T1, and then multiply those all together, and then that can give us an output. If you want more details on this example, please see this website. It explains how to do the calculation. And then there's another special case that's going to be very important for a lot of array optical systems, which is the case of periodicity. And so oftentimes, like, you may have a certain set of elements that are repeated, and they could be repeated in two ways. They could actually be arrayed in space, so you have like one unit after another, or they could actually be facing towards each other and be reflective. So that would be like a pair of mirrors, or even like a larger set of mirrors that all kind of reflect light back and forth. Classic example would be a hall of mirrors at some kind of carnival, right? So then you just have light going back and back and forth and back and forth, right? And so you can actually also capture that kind of behavior using the ray optical method. And here basically is showing that kind of the conceptual approach is that we create an ABCD matrix for each subunit, and then we would multiply the subunit to the mth power if we have m subunits. Okay, and so then that gives us like the final output after m periods. And so then for an example where you have like a pair of lenses, each of which are very thin and have different focal lengths, then you can see there are actually like four elementary units within this pair of lenses. One is basically propagation through free space, and then you go through the first focal length of the first lens, then the second region of free space, and then that second lens. And then that whole thing is repeated over and over again. So you can actually calculate by multiplying out the two pairs of elements and get basically the first pair of elements gives you optical matrix 1D minus 1 over F1, 1 minus D over F1. And then the second one, of course, with F2 instead of F1, right? But otherwise identical. multiply those together, then you get this. And then there's a stability condition, which is that A plus D absolute value must be less than or equal to 2. And so then that condition tells us, if we work through the math, that basically you need the ratio of D over F1 and D over F2 to be, I guess, large enough so that this overall term can be less than or equal to 1, but also has to be small enough so it can be greater than or equal to 0. So that's kind of the trade-off. If it doesn't fall within that range, then it'll be basically an unstable transmission, so you can't like propagate through a large number of periods that way. Similarly for a resonator, which is actually very mathematically similar, even though it looks a lot different, where you have a pair of mirrors that are facing each other with a certain curvature, you can imagine that light is actually bouncing back and forth between those mirrors repeatedly over and over again. And you can create a similar set of stability conditions. So in this case, it basically becomes something like this, where you have 1 plus D over R1, where R1 is the radius of curvature for the first lens, times 1 plus D over R2. R2 is the curvature of the second lens. And sometimes it's just written simply as the first factor is G1 and the second factor is G2. So G1 and G2 have to have a product between 0 and 1. And so then there's actually a stability diagram that you can generate for this sort of problem where essentially like certain types of mirrors are going to be fairly stable. So you can see that if you have G1 and G2 are both kind of like 1 or less, so that's the case of the planar mirror, then we can have like a very good fit. And we can keep light going back and forth, right? And then similarly, in the case of, you can see C, which is a symmetric concentric mirror, then these mirrors are actually facing towards each other and they're focusing light on one another. So the light won't escape. It can keep bouncing back and forth. And then you can see also in D, you could have one mirror that's flat and then one is curved. So it's kind of in between those two cases. Some of the other cases, however, are not going to be stable. And so you can see this one, I think it's C here, is kind of on the borderline, the symmetric concentrator. But there are other ones like B that with the symmetric and focal lens that could be unstable if you have like either of the elements is negative, but not both. So in short, what we found is that there are a range of radii of curvature or focal lengths that would give rise to stable resonators like with periodic propagation of light in the ray optics approximation. And then this has a lot of practical implications for any sort of system where you're trying to confine light. So for example, like creating a laser or light emitting diode. But we haven't really touched on the wave optics aspects. And so then that's kind of our next step in the next lecture.